They're actual pieces, plum-sized, beet-colored, with the consistency and sheen of chicken liver. Four of them have shot out of my vagina like shells from a cannon. Altogether, 18 of these projectiles will erupt from my body. Ahai, I apparently joked after the last one shot out, although I have only a vague memory of this. For now, there are only four. I'm still conscious. It's just after midnight, and my 20-year-old middle child, Sasha, who's also here.
Hey.
Sorry for forgetting you, Sasha. It's okay. My 20-year-old child, middle child, Sasha, the only other human in the apartment, added bonus on being divorced, is fast asleep after having arrived home only a few hours earlier from her birthright trip to Israel. I am bleeding out, but my brain, starved of blood and in shock at the sight of so much of it, cannot process this information. Instead, I've become convinced that the ordnance sliding around on my bathroom floor are my internal organs, which I must rescue so that someone can put them back inside me. It's a true story. So I proceed to do what anyone in my position might. I head straight to the kitchen to hunt for Tupperware. Not just any Tupperware, the glass kind. Heaven forbid my liver and kidney should come into contact with BPA. It does not even occur to me in my befuddled state that had my internal organs actually fallen from my body, I would not be rummaging in my kitchen cabinet searching for a container to store them. With the masses now safely ensconced in carcinogen-free glass on the top shelf of my fridge, I've seen enough medical procedurals to know about the importance when transporting human organs of picnic coolers. I call the answering service for my surgeon, who 3 weeks earlier had removed my cervix. This post-op emergency, which I'm not yet prepared to call an emergency, is highly unusual. In fact, of all trachelectomies, that's the fancy name for cervix removal, performed in the US, only 0.24% result in, quote, vaginal cuff dehiscence, which is the fancy name for holy Jesus fuck. The stitches where they sewed up the top of your vaginal canal have come undone, and now you are a blood clot howitzer. At this point, however, I know none of this. I just know I'm exhausted and bleeding profusely, that I'm still deep in the weeds of recovering from major surgery, that I'm in no mood for further dissection of my lady parts, that the supersized pads I've been wearing are about as useful during this exorcism as paper towels during a tsunami, that I'd already gone to the emergency room near family court 6 days after surgery when I nearly passed out from pain in the courtroom where I was representing myself to maintain primary custody of my third and youngest child. But the hospital had sent me home after having checked only the incisions on my torso, saying everything looked fine. That I am loath to cry wolf again. That my bathroom looks like a crime scene. That I will never have sex again. That no one from the hospital is calling me back. That it would be bad form to wake up a child who slept only 4 hours over the past 48 and who's starting her summer internship the following day. That it's now 1:30 in the morning. That though I'm grateful for my escape from a toxic, lonely marriage, I am as alone as I've ever felt. That part of me can't help but wonder if all of these bloody chunks shooting out of me are, in fact, metaphor, the expulsion of decades of marital sludge. That with my older son teaching English in Bangkok, and my younger son away at camp, and my boyfriend of 6 months not up for the task of caretaker, hospitals are not my thing. I've been walking the dog and doing the dishes and lifting the trash and sorting the laundry and fighting a custody battle all on my own. That none of these tasks are on the list of acceptable activities on the hospital handout they give you when they kick you out of the hospital the next morning after surgery. That though my Cobra premiums are a whopping $2,300 a month, added bonus number two, I'm recently out of a job, they do not cover the cost of a home health aide. That homemade 4th of July fireworks are going off in my neighborhood, Inwood, famous for launching both them and Lin-Manuel Miranda. That emergency rooms are often jam-packed on holiday weekends, featuring celebrations that result in immolations. That ambulances are expensive. That my retirement savings, prematurely drawn down, are dwindling. That I'm concerned that this new medical wrinkle will render my children and me homeless. That had I stayed in Paris, where I was based as a war photographer in my 20s, I would have already called an ambulance by now. That Lucas, my dog, is shaking profusely from the explosions and squatting for comfort on my face. That I don't want to leave him alone. That two more pieces of myself just shot out of me like so many Roman candles. And the rocket's red glare, indeed. Happy Independence Day to me. I thought amidst the gore. My hemorrhaging body, in all of its bursting red, turning white, and blue-faced glory, is a far more accurate representation of bootstrap-worshipping America than all of those fireworks exploding on Dyckman Street. This is what you get, I think, when the founding mothers are forbidden a quill. A bloody handprint on a wall, 241 years later, as a broken woman tries to pull herself up. The rest of the night becomes fuzzy as I slip in and out of consciousness, so I'll just mention the scenes as I do remember them in the order which I think they occurred. This is not me trying to sound postmodern. It's just the jump cut way I recall them, devoid of the normal transitions that streamline a narrative. Think Maya Darren, only real. Sweetie, I think something's wrong. I finally wake up my sleeping daughter, feeling wretched about it. I might have to go to the hospital, but you stay here with Lucas and walk him in the morning. Sasha's widened eyes, staring at the contents of my Tupperware container. The crack of fireworks. The world spinning. Mom, oh my God, that's not your kidney. If it were your kidney, you'd be dead. She pokes it with her finger, unsqueamish. She's pre-med, studying neuroscience. If I could go back in time, I think, watching her poke, I would study medicine too. The laws of chemistry elude me, but I've always liked biology. And doctors will always be needed. Journalists too, I once thought, but my profession has been imploding under the strain of free content, social media, and lost advertising for years. And right now, we're at the breaking point. In a few months, the fall of Harvey Weinstein and the rise of Me Too will uncover the abuse and harassment every woman in my industry has always known to be true, but dared not speak out loud, for fear of loss, job loss, and retribution. In fact, had I not been sexually harassed out of my beloved column at The Observer, a monthly first-person accounting of the humorous indignities of middle-aged womanhood, I'd probably be taking notes on this bloodletting right now. I think they're giant blood clots, said my daughter. We have to go to the hospital now. Me, I'm so tired, and no one's calling me back. Maybe we should just wait until tomorrow. Pools of blood on the bathroom floor, in my bed, down the hallway, in the kitchen near the Tupperware shelf and refrigerator. What's happening? Sasha, assessing. Are you kidding me? Let's go. I'm coming with you. I remain firm. No, you have to stay here with the dog. She doesn't listen. I am being pulled outside. Street lamps. Darkness. I smell pot. Nobody says pot anymore, says Sasha. It's weed. That's it. My turn on this planet is over. The number's 1:43 a.m. atop the smiles of my three sun-kissed children on the face of my phone. Uber pool. I actually order Uber pool to go to the emergency room. More fireworks. My daughter to the driver. Yes, it's an emergency. Warm blood under me, on the seat of the Uber, down my legs, in my shoes. An apology to the driver. Don't worry, just go. God bless. 2 decades earlier, when my water had broken in a taxi, the driver had spoken those exact same words. Don't worry, just go. God bless. The 20-foot distance between car and emergency room seems as unbridgeable as it had for that birth. My daughter offers me her shoulder to lean on as we exit. I am both grateful and ashamed. How, in the 20 years between soiled taxis, have our roles reversed? I have absolutely no memory of entering the hospital, but I'm told I did. Emergency room receptionist asking Sasha for my name. All of the words are outside me now. Others have taken over the task of speaking them. My name? My name! A brief snapback from the post-verbal abyss. My name! Something that should be so simple but isn't. Because my DIY divorce is taking longer than I'd expected, nearly 4 years at this point, I've petitioned the court to revert to my birth name pre-divorce, only to be told by a desk clerk that I need my ex-husband's signed and notarized permission to do so. Give them daddy's last name, I say, one last gasp of cogent strength before everything goes dark. It has been over a month since I've handed my ex the name change permission paperwork on a bench between our two apartments. The exchange felt tawdry, not unlike a dime bag drug deal in which the drug was my name and the price was my dignity. He had yet to get them notarized. I wonder if they'll insist on using my married name on my death certificate, should it come to that. If nothing else, I must stay alive to avoid that. The world tilts. My body falls, seemingly in slow motion. This is a thing backed by science, a perception of time expanding and slowing down during a moment of trauma. Darkness. My glass Tupperware container flies out of my hand, splattering on the ground, and drenches my daughter's sleeve. I have no memory of this. Overhead lights, fluorescent green glow, scared voices shouting, "What's happening?" "We have to move her to another stretcher. There's too much blood." How long have I been here? Hands under me, a sleepover levitation, light as a feather, stiff as a board. Air underneath, then boom, solid stretcher below. The antiseptic stench of the prior one being hosed down with bleach. I peek. Bad idea. A voice. "Get her into room, now!" Darkness. Irrational anger and sadness as the nurse removes my green yoga pants, now soaked red. "No, please, don't throw them out. They're my favorites." Too late, they're in the trash. Relief at having a tangible object outside of myself on which to misdirect my feelings. Darkness. Beeping. The constant gush of liquid underneath me. How much blood does a body hold? Tiny droplets of sweat on my upper lip, a warm trickle of tears down my cheeks. I am salt, on its return to the sea. I can actually feel my body dying. My brain's less scared of this than I'd always assumed it would be. I take comfort in this in case brain and body have a future. Darkness, beeping. More clots flying out, 1,000 more. No, not 1,000, says my daughter. She's been counting. We're up to 16. Her voice, "Oh God, oh my God." Then into the hallway, "Someone please get in here now." Darkness, beeping. The 18th clot emerges. My daughter's face, the one she puts on when she's trying too hard not to be afraid. "I see your fake composure, young lady, and I raise you fake levity." "Oh hi," I say. She laughs, success. Darkness, beeping. A nurse shoves massive hunks of gauze up me. This is not going to stop it, but we have no other solution until the surgeon gets here. I'm trying hard to remain literal. I have a concave body part. It's bleeding. But my brain keeps dipping into the figurative delusion of rape by cotton. I say this out loud. I don't mean to, but I do. It gets a laugh, as if it's open mic night in triage and I'm testing out new material. "Take my vagina, please." Darkness, beeping. Pressure, so much mounting pressure. Ow, ow, eject, eject. I stand up to relieve the pressure. Voices are yelling at me to lie back down. The blood-soaked gauze shoots halfway across the room where it lands with a splash in a bedpan held out like a catcher's mitt. "Score," I shout with a fist pump. Levity is all we have. Darkness, beeping. My child's voice. finally breaking.